of my life. 'Cause you're always the same. And my
Christian Church second service.
Don't worry.
Well, there are more numbers than first service, but not as loud as them. Good morning.
Good morning.
That's better. Do we have the most awesome band or what? Honestly. And today you get two announcers, as if I can't do enough. Yeah, I know it. Hey, I want to talk a minute about the rummage sale. The rummage sale, if you participated in any way, shape, or form, by bringing stuff down, by putting signs up, by hanging out, by buying stuff, any participation that you did, thank you very, very much. It was truly appreciated. It was the best part of it. You could say, well, it was nice that we earned some money for the church. We did, and that was great. But the best part of it was being here, hanging out with other people that we knew, and new people that came in through the door that had never been in Hope Church before, to hang out, to see people, and to let them know that this is really the friendliest church this side of Barstow, California, which is an odd spot to be from. But anyway, It was really great, and I thank all of you for participating. And it's all about building relationships that last forever. That's our family, but also building relationship with the Lord and serving. And that's everybody that participated in any manner at all. We're serving. And I just can't tell you how much I thought it was really, really neat. We're going to have the one-year Bible. If you still want to sign up for it, we've ordered extras and stuff like that. And the one-year Bible is, it's if you've never seen them before, and I'll go over it briefly, it's either the New King James or NIV. Sign up for either one. It's $10. It's a paperback, and it breaks it down to every day of the year, and it takes about 15 minutes to read it. By the end of the year, by the December 31st next year, you will have read the complete Bible, which is really cool. And by doing it this way, as much as we can as a church, and having access to Stan's email, anytime you come to spots that you're confused about or don't quite grasp what they're talking about, all you have to do is shoot Stan an email. And everybody else that's reading it along with us will get the benefit of what your question is, if you know, unless you don't want to ask it publicly. But we all have the same questions. We may just be shy. So if you'd like to sign up, it's out there. Jim Awe, who's going to stand up right now. Yep, that's you. Jim will have the Bibles when they come in. He'll have a list, and they're $10, $10 bill, and you just pay him. So, and he'll be coming here every Sunday and staying for both services. And so, anyways, so be dealing with Jim. He's really a good guy to deal with. Christmas Day, there's going to be a Christmas dinner here at the church. If you'd like to sign up for that and participate, it should be really a neat thing to have. It's the first year as a church that we've ever done this, so I think it's great. So please try and sign up for it if you'd like to be here. Yes, Jim? Are you going to talk all day?
When you get done, I got something to say.
Okay. Say something.
Hey, it's going to be a blessing to really have everyone, I hope, in this church read the Bible, because it's amazing how many times you read that Bible through. The more you read it, the more you know, and each time there's a whole bunch more learning in
it. And it's building a relationship with the Christ, and that's what we're trying to do. Bell ringers, if you signed up for bell ringers, I'm glad. If you haven't signed up, please sign up. We have spaces there with only one name in it, and you can put 2 or 3 people there. And it's an opportunity to sign up with somebody that you don't know. If you see a name there, go, oh, I don't know who that is. Sign up with them and go ring a bell with them. It's really cool. It's a lot of fun, and it's also a good way to get to know your church family. On Friday during the yard sale, hey, I got to tell you, this is really cool. 4:20 in the afternoon, a little guy named Connor James Howard came into the world, and that's my number 6 grandson. Yeah. Daughter Heather and Connor are both doing better than Grandpa. I can tell you that right now. Now, speaking of kids and stuff like that, we got a really, really neat announcement from Howard, and he'll handle it.
Thanks, Tom. Now you took up all my time by going and going and going. Tim, this here is a group from the Susanville National Guard. One of them, the third one from this side kneeling down, is my son. And they got home last week, well, sort of, from Afghanistan. Right now they're in Texas. By the way, this is a top secret picture. You're not supposed to see this, so I stole it off of Facebook. But anyways, this is my son's unit. They've been in Afghanistan for about a year now. They're back in Texas. They'll be home in about a week. And, you know, you don't, as a dad, you don't realize how scared you really are until it's over. You know, because before I just, he's just somewhere else. He's just somewhere else. Then he gets home, and then you about have a nervous breakdown because it's finally over. And I would just like to say, you know, to the church and to my son, who I sent a message that he has to be watching online right now, that I'm very proud of him, his unit. I know a lot of those boys and love them all like sons. So I just wanted to say thank you, God, for bringing them all back. And now, for those of you who don't know it, you are in the friendliest church this side of Ventura, which I was stuck in all week. So get up and say hello to somebody.
day when heaven's filled with His praises. One day when sin was as black as could be. Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example. Words became flesh, and the light shine on mine. His glory revealed. Living, He loved me. Dying, He saved me. Buried, He carried my sins far away. Rising, He justified. Freely forever. One day He's coming. Oh, glory. Die on a tree, suffering anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is me. And that humiliation stretched out on a tree, He took the nails for me. Word of God speaks. You pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty. To be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay in your holiness. Word of God speak. I'm finding myself in the midst of you. Beyond music, beyond the noise, all that I need is to be with you in the quiet. Hear your voice, word of God speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know you're in this place. Please let me stand in your holiness. Word of God speak. Would you pour down my grain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay in your holiness. Word of God speak. I'm finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. Seated above, enthroned in the Father's love, destined to die, poured out for all mankind. God's only Son, perfect and spotless one. Never sinned, but suffered as if he did. All authority, every victory is yours. Say the worthy of honor. Jesus, awesome and powerful, forever awesome and great is your name. You are the King. Power in heaven, speaking the Father's plan, sending us in this broken land. All authority, every victory is yours. Savior, worthy of honor and glory, worthy of thank you. testimony, everyone overcome. We will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony, everyone.
Us so much, he sent his son to the earth to save us. At the cross, he took our sins on his body. He shed his blood for the forgiveness of our sins. And he brought us into a covenant relationship with God. We are saved, we are forgiven, and we are free. In communion, we remember his body and his blood, which was sacrificed for us. With the gift of his son, we rejoice because God is with us.
Of light.
to me now. When lay your hand over me, will you find me tonight? Say it will be all right. I will believe. Broken and two. When I knew your arms to me, that I only come home when I'm so all alone. That not everything is gonna be the way you think it ought to be. Seems like every time I try to make it right, it all comes down on me. Please say honestly you won't give up on me, Michelle.
Church, second service. You glad to be here today? Yeah, it's good to see everybody. We welcome you. We also welcome you if you're watching online and joining us on your iPhone or Droid or PC or whatever gadget you got. We're really glad that you're with us. And we're in a series called Celebrate. Are you guys ready to party? Are you ready to celebrate? Amen. Have you gotten to the point in this, as we've done this series, to realize that you can celebrate all the time, that it's okay with God, in fact, it's biblical, and that there comes a time when you gotta get to where it's not about circumstances. Happiness is based on happenings, but there's a deeper thing than just happenings. There's a deeper thing than just feelings. I get feelings from a burrito. There's a deeper sense of joy that is not dependent on outward circumstances. It's knowing that I'm okay because God is here and God's gonna take care of me. And no matter what anybody else says, I can still cut loose and rejoice and enjoy my life. That's where we wanna get in this series. I put some definitions down on the word celebrate to help you think about it as we're in this series. Number one, to rejoice, to party, to enjoy yourself, to live it up, to whoop it up. There's one we don't use a lot. Hey, let's whoop it up today. To make merry, to paint the town red. I've heard that one before. I'm not sure where it comes from. I'm not sure I want to know, but painting the town red. To go on a spree, to large it up. That's the Brit way of saying celebrate. Let's large it up. To roister, put the flags out, kill the fatted calf. Number two, to commemorate, honor, toast, to drink to. Sometimes you keep a celebration in honor of someone or something. Number three, to perform or observe or preside over, to officiate, to show reverence. You know, reverence is even a part of celebrating. When we have communion, Jesus said, when you get together, do this in remembrance of me. And so it's a kind, even if you're quiet, it's a sober celebration. It's a reason. We think about the cross and we think about the forgiveness we have and that the fact that God took care of our debt, that we're free and we don't have to live in free fear with this God. He's not mad at us. He did it at the cross. That's what it's about. And so we celebrate that. Number four, to praise, to honor, to commend. It can be, that's an informal. It can be to glorify, to publicize, to exalt, laud, extol, big up. That's Caribbean. It's kind of like large up. We're going to big up today. Eulogize. You hear a eulogy at a funeral. It's celebrating the memory of someone dear to you. And so this word celebrate can be taken in a lot of different ways. And we've been looking about how in the Bible, really, it is rooted in the idea that God wants us to be thankful. That he told the Jews, I want you to have these certain festivals. Shut down everything. Quit working and do these parties. He basically said, party or you die. He didn't say it's an option to try them. He said, I want you to observe them. You get in the New Testament. We studied this in the first week, celebrating with Thanksgiving daily, not just an annual event, but living in Thanksgiving. And remember, the disciples came back from a campaign and they said, Lord, even the demons submit to us in your name. And it's really cool because as we looked at it, Jesus was happy because it says that he was full of the Holy Spirit, full of joy from the Holy Spirit. And he said, I praise you, Heavenly Father. He praised God. And he says, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. So Jesus is pumped up at this event when this is, hey, he's excited. But then he says, remember what he said? Rejoice not that the demons submit to you, but rather that your name is written in heaven. And every single one of us, there's no, I'll pick this one, but not that one with God. Every single one of us, if we put our faith in Christ, we become a Christ one, follower of him. We can know our name, your name. There may be some places where your name is that you wish it wasn't. I can relate. But if your name is in heaven, that's all that matters. And you don't have to live in fear. And so you can celebrate. We talked about relationships, that we get relationships that last forever in the church. And though we leave at different times, we will meet again for a forever family reunion. And so we should celebrate. You know, we talked in our group last week. It really touched me as I was it just hit me when we were talking. It's like, what really matters to most, the most to us? When you think about it, in this life, when you get to the end of, what is it that really matters the most? And we all boiled it down to relationships, your family, your friends, your loved ones. We get to the end of our life, we're not going to be worried about what's going to happen to my iPhone, you know, what's going to happen to the computer, you know, what's going to happen to our car. We're not going to think about it. That's not the most important things. The stuff that we're tempted to chase all the time, especially Christmas and all this time, which can be depressing when you're being pressured. You got to get this, you got to buy this, you got to buy that. Stuff really isn't the biggie in our life. It's loving God and it's loving people. And so we talked about that. We talked about celebrating life itself, that God is not a part of our life. He is our life. And that's what we read in the Word. That and I thought, well, I got to do the God thing, but I can't have fun, so I'll wait till I get everything, you know, out of my system, and then I'll come to the God, hopefully before I die and go to heaven. And what I came to learn, that some of the stuff that I thought was so fun wasn't so fun after all. And what I found with God is it's okay to have fun. He thought it up. And really, it's more fun when he's in the center. And it doesn't mean you have to be perfect, because how many are? Anybody here perfect? Always nervous when I ask that question. Nobody raises their hand. We all fall short. That's what it's all about. It's not because we got it all together. It's the fact that we don't. And when people say, well, I don't want to go to church. Hypocrites go there. I always want to say, that's the best place for them. We're all sinners. Hypocrites go to the gas station. You're going to quit going to the gas station because hypocrites go there. You know, we all fall short. And that doesn't make it okay and all that. I get that. But you can be real and you can be in a climate of grace and know that we're accepted because of Christ. So we can celebrate no matter what. And today I wanted to go into this idea of Emmanuel, God with us, because it's Christmas time. It's a word we sometimes sing, and yet I don't know if we understand what is it. Is that some guy, Manuel? Who's Manuel? You know, it's Emmanuel. Emmanuel really has a powerful meaning behind it when you dig into when it first came in Isaiah, because it's actually during a time of difficulty. It's during a time of darkness. It's during a time of fear that this word and this prophecy comes out. And uncertainty in the world, fear of insecurity, of hard times is when this came out. And I want to take you to Isaiah 7. I'm going to read some kind of large sections. Try to hang in there with me. If you want to go to Isaiah 7, you can read with me. Otherwise, you could just kind of chill and listen. And just think of this. This is the context. There's this guy named Ahaz who's a king, and he doesn't really live as a believer in God. Now, he's a king in Judah. He's supposed to have God in his heart, and they're the people of God. But he gets sucked into trusting things of the world and trying to provide security and safety through alliances with people and things that aren't of God. And so there's judgment coming down the pike at him because he's trusting in other things. And listen in chapter 7. When Ahaz, son of Jotham, the son of Uzziah, was king of Judah, King Rezin of Aram and Pekah, son of Remaliah, king of Israel, there's some good names to name your kids, marched up to fight against Jerusalem. But they could not overpower. Now the house of David was told, Aram has allied itself with Ephraim. So the hearts, notice this, the hearts of Ahaz and his people were shaken as the trees of the forest are shaken by the wind. We have some beautiful trees around us, amen? Have you ever noticed when the storm comes how those babies move? Oh, yeah. Yeah, they really move. And their hearts were really shaken with fear like that. Now notice what God says. Verse 3, then the Lord said to Isaiah, go out, you and your son Shear Jashub. Now, if you're looking in your Bible, you got a little letter there, like I have a C. I don't know what yours would be, but that's a footnote. And you go down, and it tells you what the meaning of that name is. Shear Jashub means a remnant will return. See, God has given a promise through Jerusalem that one day, through Abraham, that God would build this covenant with David and that he would set up a kingdom and that it would last forever. The problem is Israel got into thinking, well, we need the other stuff too. We need the other gods. We need to be like the rest of the world. So God's going to let them go into captivity, but he's going to bring out a faithful remnant. God is always faithful to his promises. So we go down here. He tells him to take his kid that's got that name, and it says, go meet Ahaz at the end of the aqueduct to the upper pool on the road to the washerman's field. So say to him, listen to this, be careful, keep calm, and don't be afraid. Do not lose heart because of these two smoldering stubs of firewood, because of the fierce anger of Rezin and Aram and of the son of Remaliah. You see that? There's threat. He's afraid, and he says, be careful, keep calm, don't be afraid. When you get news of an attack, or you're suffering an attack, is your first reaction to be calm and not afraid? Not mine either. But that's the word from God. God says, be calm, do not be afraid, do not lose heart. He calls them smoldering stubs of firewood. These big nations that think they're all that, they're coming against you. God says they're just like a little ash pile, a little bit of smoldering stubs of firewood. He says you don't have anything to worry about is what he's saying. Aram, Ephraim, Remaliah's son have plotted your ruin, saying, let us invade Judah. Let us tear it apart and divide it among ourselves and make the son of Tabeel king over it. Yet this is what the sovereign Lord says. It will not take place. It will not happen. For the head of Aram is Damascus, and the head of Damascus is only Rezin with 65 years. Within 65 years, Ephraim will be too shattered to be a people. The head of Ephraim is Samaria, and the head of Samaria is only Remaliah's son. If you do not stand firm in your faith, you will not stand at all. Do you hear that? If you do not stand firm in your faith, you will not stand at all. Again, the Lord spoke to Ahaz, ask the Lord your God for a sign, whether in deepest depths or in the highest heights. But Ahaz said, I will not ask, I will not put the Lord to the test. Now, what I've found digging around in different scholars' writings about this, they said he's not really being all churchy and religious and believing. He's trying to act like he is. Oh, I don't want to put God to the test. Because he really doesn't live by faith, trusting in God. So he's really trying to do it as a cop-out. Oh, I don't want to bother God. I don't want to talk to God. I don't want to do this test to see if God's with me. Verse 13, then Isaiah said, "Hear now, you house of David. Is it not enough to try the patience of men? Will you try the patience of my God also? Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign." He says, God's going to give you a sign anyway. You know, you can say, I don't want it, I want to hear it. Well, you're going to hear it. The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel. He will eat curds and honey when he knows enough to reject the word, the wrong, and choose the right. But before the boy knows enough to reject the wrong and choose the right, the land of the two kings you dread will be laid waste. So he says these two people that you think are all that and you're all afraid of, by the time a baby's born and grows to the age that he knows right or wrong, which some say that's around 12, you get to 12 years in history, this actually happens. So there is a specific context that appear. He's not just telling Ahaz, don't worry, in 2,000 years there's going to be a baby born in Bethlehem, which will mean Emmanuel, God with us. He's telling him in your day, in your time, they're in your context, this is going to happen. We don't know if it was Ahaz's baby, if it was, I don't think it was Isaiah's baby. We have some of his other children named. Could be a symbolic general meaning that in the time that a baby is born, you're going to realize God with us. And you go down to chapter 8, there's this judgment pronouncement, verse 6. Because the people have rejected the gently flowing waters of Shiloh and rejoices over Rezin and the son of Remaliah, therefore the Lord is about to bring against them the mighty floodwaters of the river, the king of Assyria, with all its pomp. It will overflow all its channels, run over all its banks, and sweep on into Judah, swirling over it, passing through it, and reaching up to the neck. Its outspread wings will cover the breadth of your land, O Emmanuel. So Emmanuel is also used in judgment. God is coming. You know, God with us is a cool thing if you're with God. But if God with us is coming at you, you got trouble here. And so he goes on to say, raise the war cry, you nations, and be shattered. Listen, all you distant lands, prepare for battle and be shattered. Prepare for battle and be shattered. Devise your strategy, but it will be thwarted. Purpose your plan, but it will not stand, for God is with us. Everybody say, God is with us. Then he says, the Lord spoke to me with his strong hand upon me. This is Isaiah talking now, warning me not to follow the way of this people. He said, do not call conspiracy everything that these people call conspiracy. Do not fear what they fear and do not dread it. The Lord Almighty is the one you are to regard as holy. He is the one you are to fear. He is the one you are to dread. And he will be a sanctuary. But for both houses of Israel, he will be a stone that causes men to stumble and a rock that makes them fall. Jesus was called that because people who reject him, he's a stone that causes them to stumble. And then he says, and for the people of Jerusalem, he will be a trap and a snare. Many of them will stumble. They will fall and be broken. They will be snared and captured. Now listen to this. Bind up this testimony. See what he's saying? Write this down. He's saying, make this agreement and seal up the law among my disciples. Here's what it is. I will wait for the Lord who is hiding his face from the house of Jacob. I will put my trust in him. Everybody say, I will put my trust in him. Doesn't that feel good? You were created for that. You were made to that. Now, here's why I wanted to go here with this. Christmas time is for some people a very excited, a wonderful, great memories, celebrative time. For other people, it's a lonely time, a depressing time. For some, it's a materialistic machine and a guilt trip because they don't have to get what they'd like to get. So there's all these things going on. But when Emmanuel came out, that prophecy, they weren't sitting in a beautiful little A-frame church singing Christmas carols. You know what I'm saying? It wasn't this bubbly, fun, happy time when God says, Emmanuel, God with us. It was a judgment time. It was a time of destruction. It was a time of darkness. And yet God says these points that I want to dig out of the text and give to you before we conclude. Number one, do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. He says, don't be afraid of these things that are up against you. He's afraid of his security. That's one of our biggies in life, isn't it? We're human beings, and we can get afraid of our security. People will do some wild things for security. They will sell their bodies. They will sell their souls. They will steal. They will do all kinds of stuff because they want security. Now, I kind of think a king who's got two nations coming at him has some pretty good argument for a reason to feel some fear. And listen, you're a human being, I think you are, and if you've ever had something big come at you and your first reaction is to be afraid, don't beat yourself. I'm not trying to guilt trip us all here because we're human and there are things that can be scary. But I think the message is you've got to go and you've got a journey in your faith where you get to the point where you hear, do not be afraid, calm down, Emmanuel is coming. God is with us, and if God is with you, you don't have to cower in fear. That's the difference for a people of faith. God calls us to believe his word and find security in troubled times. Look at verses. I put them on your outline again. Verse 3 says, then the Lord said to Isaiah, go out, you and your son, Shear, Jashub, to meet Ahaz. Say to him, be careful, keep calm. And don't be afraid. Do not lose heart because of the smoldering stubs of firewood. There's times in my life where keeping calm sounds like the most craziest thing. The beginning of this year, New Year's Eve, we got a call that Allie had meningitis. Allie is my first child, and she lives in New York. And we're like, what? I started Googling, what is meningitis? And it got scarier and scarier as I read. And then I got a call or a text, and it said, keep praying. She's taking a turn for the worse. And her language was just gibberish, and her husband's freaking out. And I was on my knees in our living room just crying, oh, God, don't take Allie. Not our Allie. She's such a sweet person. God, everybody, we need her. And her husband and her boys need her. And I cried out. It was a terrible, lousy, cruddy, fearful New Year's Eve. You know, Happy New Year, you know. And thank God he healed her, and she says, a little bit of hearing loss, but it could have been so much worse. Scary times. And you and I go through things in this fallen world where we're tempted to lose it. But God, you know, the thing about God is he never lets you wimp out. He never says, oh, yeah, poor you. Let's have a pity party. Isn't this horrible? Let's just sit around and talk about it. Everything sucks, you know, and it's just life is, and let's be a energy depleting vortex to everybody who comes around us and just suck the energy out of their life because we're so, God never lets us do that. He says, be calm, don't be afraid, and trust in me. I love verse 14. Therefore, the Lord himself will give a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son. We'll call him Emmanuel. Before the boy knows enough to reject the wrong and choose the right, the land of these two kings will be laid waste. And that's exactly what happened in the history, in the context where Ahaz is told not to be afraid. Now, when you go to number 2, I want to put down, God will take care of us. God will take care of us. Sometimes you don't know how he's going to take care of us, and they're facing a lot of hard times ahead, but God says, I'm going to provide, I'm going to bring a faithful remnant out, and God is on the throne, not us. That's why he says, raise the war cry, you nations, and be shattered. Listen, all you distant lands, prepare for battle and be shattered. Be prepared for battle and be shattered. Devise your strategy, but it will be thwarted. Propose your plan, but it will not stand, for God is with us. So, to a dark time, 700 years later, a little over that, to a guy who's engaged, kind of like engaged, betrothed, a little stronger than engagement, to be married, he finds out his fiance, Mary, is with child. One little challenge going on here is they have not had sex. Oh, great. Now, that's kind of challenging sometimes in our culture to be found with child, to not be married. And unfortunately, sometimes people can be very mean. But does anybody know what happened in this time period when a girl was found to be with child and not married? She was stoned, and not the kind that makes you happy. Stoned to death. She was stoned to death. This is a scary thing. So you can kind of understand why the angel might say, hey, don't be afraid. I think that Joseph is shaking in his boots. Listen, we give Mary a great time, and we should. She's an awesome servant of God. I love when she goes, when she finds out what's going to happen. She says, blessed be the Lord. Behold, I am the Lord's servant. She just has that great faith. And I love that we honor Mary, and we should. But sometimes I don't think we give Joseph enough credit. I mean, this guy, this is a scary, dark time. It's also a time when Israel's under reign and power of another nation. It's a tough time. There's good reason to be afraid is what I'm trying to say. And look what he says to him on your outline. Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid. Everybody say, do not be afraid.
Do not be afraid.
Yeah, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. The name Jesus, another name that God saves. That's what the name is. It's the ideal of Savior. And Jesus is the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last. And Jesus is the one who saves. And Jesus is the Good Shepherd. And all these awesome names mean something. And here we find verse 22. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him, what? Emmanuel, which means God with us. All right, look to the people to your left and your right and your front and your back and say, God is with us. God is with us. God is with us. If you believe in Jesus, Emmanuel means that. God is with us. And I know that there's a sense that God is with everybody. He loves everybody. Paul made a speech once in Athens to some people that were, quote, very religious. They had all kinds of little gods, little g, and they had one in case we're missing one. They go to an unknown God. They even had an idol to an unknown God. Got everything covered now, right? And he says, I'm going to tell you about the unknown God. And he gives this incredible speech about Jesus. And in the context of that speech, he says, for one man, God made all the peoples of the earth, and he made them to inhabit the lands. And he put them where they, did you know God's ultimately in charge, and where I live and the people I grow up among is part of God's design? So I better be careful about complaining with the people that God puts in my life. Are you with me there? He put us in this context. And then he goes on to say, God did this so that men might seek him and perhaps find him, though he's not far from any one of us. As though one of your poets said, in him we live and move and have our very being. So God is with us in the sense that he's all around. But now let's get back to our lesson before I go on and on about that. That when he says Emmanuel, God with us in Matthew, he's saying that just is not a human baby that's being born in that feeding trough, in that dingy, dark, smelly barnyard kind of atmosphere where you smell manure and you hear the sound of animals and there's a threat of this crazy king that wants to kill all the babies all around, all the Jewish babies, all this scary stuff going on. There's a baby being born, but it ain't just a human baby. It's a God baby. Emmanuel, God with us. Jesus is God. He is deity. So Emmanuel means more than the idea that God is just around us. And it's awesome that God is with us. If God is with us, who can be against us? Paul said in Romans. I mean, who can effectively bring us down if God is with us, is what Paul is saying. Nothing will separate us from the love of God. So point number three, lift up your heart and give him glory. Lift up your heart and give him glory. I love how he says in verse 16, bind up this testimony of warning and seal up God's instruction among my disciples. He's saying, spread around my disciples this teaching, this important teaching about this judgment coming against people who try to go against me. And then he says, verse 17, I will wait for the Lord, who is hiding his face from the descendants of Jacob. I will put my trust in him. Say, I will trust in him. Yeah, see, that's what he's saying. When trouble comes and things look scary and we're afraid or tempted to be afraid, you and I need to say, I will wait for the Lord. I will trust in him. 29 months ago, we began a new work together here at Hope Church. And we said, well, what do we do? And we said, let's have a prayer chain, because we felt desperate. And we wanted to be led by God, not ourselves. And we entered the year saying, hey, rather than let's just make a plan and say, God, bless my plan, let's ask God for his plan and to lead us. We're going to do another one at the end of this month. We'll have a sign-up sheet out there if you'd like to take a 30-minute time and pray, and then you call the person after you. As soon as our pastor gets it done and gets a sign-up sheet, we'll have one out there, and you can sign up. Then we gather after 24 hours nonstop prayer. We gather here for the three P's. Praise and prayer and pizza, and it's just a time. I love that we do that the last week of the year before the new year. Those who can, we understand it's a busy, everybody can't go to everything, but those who can, we come together and say, God, lead us. And I believe that's one of the reasons we've grown and we are growing, and God keeps doing stuff among us, because we keep saying, I will wait for the Lord, I will put my trust in him. And that's what he's saying to this king, who's got every reason to say, look how bad things are. He says to him, you got to put your trust. Now, I got to read to you from chapter 9. Chapter 9, back in Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 9 says, for us, a child is born. To us, a son is given. And the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God. More names again for Jesus. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on for and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. That prophecy, 700 years before Jesus came, told about a government that would come that would never end. But he wasn't talking about a physical government. We still mix it up. The spiritual government. The king is Jesus. The territory is wherever heart of a man or a woman accepts Christ as their king. And the gathering of the kingdom of God on earth is sometimes called the church, the body of Christ. When we gather, did you know we're a part of that everlasting kingdom? That's what the baby brought. He brought this eternal kingdom. And we gather together, we're part of a kingdom that will never end. You know, every time we have an event here, I plan this event, or with the board we talk about it, or with the ministry leaders, or someone has an idea from the body, we do it, like the reading the Bible all year. Jim all kept pushing that. Yeah, it's a good deal. Bible's a good thing. Amen. Let's do it. So every time we do it, though, right before, I always go to this dark time. A cloud comes over my house, you know, and I planned this rummage sale. We had a campaign to raise funds. We want to get to where we're self-supported status, where we're not having to have outside support. We had a goal, rise up. So we thought, we know those are hard times. What about if everybody can play a part. Everybody can bring some kind of item of junk, stuff, and put it in the rummage sale. And right before we got started, I started thinking this last week, what a dumb idea to have a rummage. What was I thinking? It's Christmas time. We've got all this family stuff and all these events. But I wanted to do a campaign rather than hope we rise up, as we said, as a goal for the year. Hope we do it and eke in there without ever mentioning it. I wanted to end the year campaigning. So we did an outreach with a Rock the Ridge. We're doing an in-reach thing. We're going to have next week where we have celebrate our gifts and our ministries and have a Christmas potluck. And we did a financial thing where we strive and we have this rummage sale. So that was the plan. And then people started walking in these doors. And our members, I was sitting there by the cash register, of course, and I was sitting there, and I hear all these people, welcome, come on in, and joking around stuff like, hey, we got more stuff tomorrow on Saturday, and if you come on Sunday, you get the good news for free, ha, ha, ha. And we just listened to all the backslapping and all the love going on, and it was awesome. And, you know, we had talks with people from our community who thought they were just coming in here to look at our stuff, but they had to talk to us. It was so awesome. And it was the kingdom of God. That's what God does. God blesses. You know, I got up here. The first day I made it by 6. The second day I wanted to get here at 6, and I set my alarm. Alarm went off, and I shut it off. You ever, like, go back to sleep, but you think you're awake? I mean, I was like, I was going through the practice of getting ready. You know, in my mind, I got to get down there, and it's going to be another great day. And then I hear my phone ring, and I realize I was asleep. So I go to answer the phone, and I can see it's Tom Turkington. I'm like, oh, great. And it's actually 6 now already. And so I get ready to answer the phone. You ever answer that with that fake voice where you're trying to act like you weren't sleeping? You know what I mean? Oh, yeah, hey, Tom, yeah, no worries. No worries, yeah. He's like, are you going to have enough down there? He had to do some chores. Are you going to have enough down there to help you get it started? Oh, yeah, no problem, no problem. I don't have a clue if anybody's down there. But I jump in my truck and I hurry down here and I come in. Thank God Ron had got here early and Joe and some others. And I knew Barbara would be here and she'd give me a hard time for being late. So what I did was I drove around to the cabin because there's an old drum set there I wanted to get that we never use and put that on the sale. So I come walking in about 6:20 acting like, see, I'd already been working. That's why I did it. Oh, you guys are here. I was out back getting the drums, you know. And anyway, so it was just an awesome time together, you know, and all of us laughing and everything. And then Tracy and Abby were counting at the end of the day, and we were just under 1,500 is where we were at that point. And I was blown away by that. We were thinking, but Tracy was thinking, it'd be so good, though, if we could just get over the 1,500. And I got a text, and Will said, me and Shannon are going to buy the elliptical machine. I said, yes, for two reasons. I got it out of my garage, and now it's in his place. No, but it put us over 1,500. We made 1,516 in our rummage sale. Isn't that awesome? So we're now, if you look in the bulletin, it says stand fund 26. Now we're over $4,000 in that. That's to help us with our, you know, that is just like Tom said, small potatoes, though. What is going on in our relationships and in the kingdom of God is awesome. And all different kinds of people coming together. Now this year we went to double services. Who knows what he's going to do ahead. But God is working through us. Emmanuel is with us. And I want to end with this verse because we need to get home and watch the Niners. 2 Corinthians 4, 14 and 15. It's a context in 2 Corinthians where Paul is under fire. And people are saying, Paul isn't all that. He's nobody. And Paul's under attack, and rather than just say, hey, look, I'm all that, I'm awesome, I'm this, I'm that, he doesn't do that. He says, yeah, I'm weak. He says, in fact, we are earthen vessels, we're cracked pots, we're broken jars of clay, but inside of us, there is this treasure. Say, I'm an earthen vessel. I thought you'd say, stands an earthen vessel. No, stands a crackpot. We're all earthen vessels. This is a temporary shell that we have. But when you come into Christ, Emmanuel is in you. God with us is in you. And you have this treasure. And look what he says. He says on the outline that I gave you, verse 14, we know that the one who raised the Lord Jesus from the dead will also raise us with Jesus and present us with you to himself. All this is for your benefit, he's saying to the church that he started. He says, so that the grace that is reaching more and more people may cause what? Thanksgiving to overflow to what? The glory of God. So point number three I forgot to give you is lift up your heart and give him glory. You see, we don't bring God glory when we're grumpy. I'm not trying to give you a guilt trip to never get grumpy. You got to work through it. We all do. But we don't give God. See, there's this idea that to be a Christian, you got to be pissed off all the time. Oh, I said I wasn't going to say that word again publicly. But then, you know, Jesus said, when you lose your salt, it's good for nothing but the dung pile. You know, Jesus said that. And to act like we're so spiritual when we're judgmental are critical, and we have no joy, and we complain and whine, we have no power. Emmanuel is not living in us. Emmanuel is living in us when we rejoice, even when it's difficult, and we say, I will not be afraid. God will protect us. There's this tenacity you can get from Christ, not from you, from God, Emmanuel, that couple who were told they're going to have a child, they had every reason to be afraid, but they were said, do not be afraid. God is with you, Emmanuel. We can understand then that we can lift up our heart and give God glory, even in times of judgment. The point of Emmanuel, this is it, true security from all danger, even judgment, comes by faith in God's supernatural provision of Emmanuel. So whether you have a fun memory of Christmas or not, you can have the best one ever this year. Cut through all the baloney and look at that child, Emmanuel, God with us. And no matter what dark times you're up against the new year, fiscal cliff, smiscal cliff, I don't care what the media throws at us, Emmanuel, Emmanuel, God is with us. Let's pray. As you pray, I pray that you'll hear the Spirit's encouragement to not be afraid, no matter what you're up against. And I pray you'll understand that we have a God who's crazy about you. He loves us so much that he sent his Son for us. And you do have security in him. And so today he wants you to give him all your fears. It's kind of like an offering. You lay it at his feet. Today, claim these promises as I pray. You can pray from your heart as I pray. Father, forgive us when we cower in fear over lesser things. Help us to take those dark moments and take that object and compare it to you. And remember, Emmanuel, God is with us. We don't have to live in fear, and you have promised to take care of us. Father, help us to be a people who are full of joy, because like your scripture says, when more and more people come to you through grace, it causes thanksgiving, and the thanksgiving overflows to your glory. It's not our complaining that overflows to your glory, it's our thanksgiving. So we celebrate anyway. We thank you that we can be tenacious. We can be spiritual bulldogs because of Emmanuel, God with us. In his name we pray, amen. Let's stand together and worship God.
Glory.
now it's time to pray for our offering. Yeah, let's pray. As we're bound, if you're a guest today, this service is our gift to you, and we don't want anybody to give that's not prospering or go out of this place feeling manipulated or guilty in any way. Those of us that have been prospering are able, we give as an act of worship. Lord, we got out of bed this morning because of you. Everything that we have is yours, and so we have this act of worship through giving. We thank you for all our blessings, and we pray that you make hope a force for good and hope on the ridge and beyond until Jesus comes, and we pray in his name. Amen.
Amen.
Hey, before we give, what is our purpose? Amen. So until next week, remember, in Christ, we always have hope. Thanks for being here.
We'll see. Through you the mute will sing. Through you the dead will rise. Through you our hearts will praise. Through you the darkness flees. Through you my heart screams.
Have a great week.